house. I'm fascinated by the shape and symbolism that's attached to houses, and so you'll understand why I'm so excited to share the latest incarnation of the shape with you today. I'm thrilled to present Joggles' Wonky Wood Houses and hope you'll join me in creating some. If you watch our videos, you know that houses are a shape that appear quite frequently. We have wonky houses in the stencil line and in the stamp line, and it's a shape that I really enjoy working with. To me, home means family, it means security, it's a place where celebrations happen, and it's a place where you can retreat to when the world just gets to be too much. So I was really looking forward to exploring this shape in 3D, and what you see here is the culmination of months of work trying to find a way to get these made. Ultimately, they were made by hand in Connecticut by my son-in-law, and we've created them based on some designs that I drew. There are four in this line at the moment, and will there be more? It's a little hard to know at this point. I'm hoping that everyone will like them enough and I can come up with some more shapes. So they're made from paint-grade poplar, which means that there's very little in the way of knots or blemishes. The surfaces are beautifully smooth, they've been cut perfectly, and they require next to no sanding. So I want to start out today showing you how to create this house right here. And the first one that I made, and you can see by the sides here, that I actually did not gesso this, but I'm going to take that back and say, for my purposes, I'm going to gesso everything that I work on, regardless of what I'm going to do with it. What happens is that the color of the wood, as light as it is, does affect whatever you put on top of it, so adding gesso is a really good way to calm that down and to get more of a white surface so that your colors stay true. So I'm going to show you how I apply gesso, and you can see here that it is most assuredly not perfect, and there's a reason for that, mostly because I can't be bothered. As you know, I feel imperfection is much easier to achieve, but also because it gives you some variations. When you look here, you can see that there are variations in the color, and I like the idea that there's some shading, there's some lights and some darks. So I'm working with Dina Wakely's gesso and her palette knife. Now the one thing that I want to mention, gesso is available a couple of different ways. There's this 4-ounce jar, and then there's the 2-ounce tube. Now one of the things that you're going to notice is that, first of all, this is on backwards. It's because I've cut this off. I do this with hand lotion, I do this with anything that comes in a tube, maybe bar toothpaste. If you cut the top off something like this and you look inside, you're going to see that there's actually a lot of product in there. I'm way too cheap to throw that out. So go ahead and cut that off, and then if you use your palette knife, you'll see just how much of this is in here. Now I've actually already used some of this, but the point is well made that there's a lot in that tube once you can't squeeze anything out anymore, so there's no need to waste it. So all I want to do is just take the palette knife and get the gesso on all the sides of this. I do the front and the back, I do the sides of the roof, I do the bottom. Now obviously you can only do this a little bit at a time because you've got to have a place where you can hold this. So typically I'll do several at once, and then I will put them down and let them dry, and then I'll come back and I'll grab, you know, I'll work with multiple ones, and then once the sides are dry, I can come back and do the ones that I haven't actually gotten to yet. So this really is it, and as I said, all of the houses start this way. Even the ones that I'm going to show you, especially this tissue paper one, I'm going to show you, because if you choose to use colors other than the warm browns that I did, then it will definitely affect that. But you can see that the surface, if I turn this, you can see that the surface is not even. That's deliberate, especially when we're going to get to the finger painting part. That's going to really make a difference, and you'll see how it does affect the way the paint goes on and how it changes, and you can see those ripples and those bubbles. So let me move this out of the way. Let's just put this over here where it's out of the way. I'm going to stick my palette knife in some water. Actually, let me grab a piece of paper towel. I'm going to do this so that I don't want the gesso to dry in the palette knife, because it makes a mess if it does. So again, be sure that you use everything, whether it's the paint or the gels and mediums. Go ahead and use it all so that you don't waste it. All right, so now let's come back and talk about this. Tim Holtz has a roll of tissue paper that's called, he's got more than one, but the one that I'm using is called Melange. It's filled with these absolutely beautiful images of moths and butterflies, as well as some text and some music. Now this pattern repeats, so you can see, let's see where we are. You see the giant moth here, and if I unroll this a little bit more, you'll see the moth begin to appear again. So when I worked on the first one, I actually had a leftover piece from something else, and it had one of the moths on it. Now obviously these houses are very different in size, so I was only able to squeeze a little bit on, and this is, I believe this is the same repeat, it's just that here you're seeing one side, you're seeing a small section, and here you're seeing almost the entire moth. So with that said, all I did was cut a piece off the roll that encompassed at least one of the moths, because I wanted this to be very much the focal point, especially on this large house. So you can see, again, gesso everywhere. Now there's a little bit of something on here, but at the end of the day, I'm really not worried about it, and it did come off quite easily. So what I want to do is take advantage of this beautiful big moth and get it on here. Now obviously, because of the way that I cut this, I need to place the moth more toward the top of the house, which is fine. I don't have a problem with that. I could slide this over a little bit like this, and I can just squeeze that in there like that. So that's going to leave me some room at the bottom to do some things, and then I can really emphasize this. So here's the way that I put this on. You can either attach this with gel medium, and here I have Dina Wakely's gel medium. Any kind of a soft glue that you can spread with a brush will work. So what I'm going to do, again, I'm going to use the gel medium. You can use Ranger's glue and seal. It has a little brush built into the small container. Anything that you can use like that will work. So what I want to do is get this, I want to get the entire surface covered. Now I'm not going to do the sides or the bottom or the sides of the roof. We'll get to those a little bit later. But I need to get a coat on here, and you do have to work quickly enough so that you're going to apply this and all of the gel medium is still going to be wet. It's not going to be helpful if you're fighting because the gel medium has dried on you. So you want to get a nice smooth coat, because if you have lumps and bumps, they will definitely affect how the tissue paper lays. But by the same token, you won't need to get enough on there. So you kind of have to find the happy medium. So I'm going to turn this, and there are lines on here. There's lines of text. There's lines in the sheet music. You can use that either with the sides or the bottom of the house to help you get a good placement. Now, again, I need to bear in mind what I'm doing here relative to that top. But I'm going to slide this down. Now you do have to be somewhat careful how you do this so that you don't actually tear the tissue, because once it gets damp, it does get a little bit soft. So all I'm doing is going ahead and rubbing this on, and I will tell you that I've used both the gel medium and the glue and seal, and in each case I can feel this. It's wet through the tissue. What that means is that there's a little bit of bleeding going on. So, not that it matters, it's just if you feel it, you'll know that it's okay. So what I want to do is trim all this excess off, because what's going to happen is as it curls and it hits the table, it's going to stop the edges from adhering properly. So I just like to get this out of here, and then I can come back, and if I need to hit this tip again, I can, just to make certain that everything's on there nice and tight. Now, you need to, I got a spot here. You're going to need to trim this off, and I have found the best way to do this is with an X-Acto knife with a nice new blade in it. You don't want to use anything that's dull, and what you don't want to do is try to cut this while the paper is still damp. You have to give this time to dry so that when you come along with the X-Acto knife, and I'm going to show you this in 1 second, I just need to turn this over and get it to dry. And excuse me, I need to get this dry, and then I'll turn it over. I'm going to cut from the other side, but what will happen is when you use this X-Acto knife, if you try to pull it through paper that's damp and you catch just a little bit, you're liable to actually get some wrinkling that goes on the edge here, and obviously you don't want that. You need a nice, clean cut. So I'll let this dry, and then I'll come back, and I'll show you how to trim this off and then what the next steps are. Everything's dry now, so I can go ahead and trim the excess tissue paper off. I can't emphasize it enough. Don't use a dull blade. Put a new one in. It's going to make life a lot easier, and you're going to get better results. I'm going to use the side of the wood as my guide. I don't need a ruler or anything like that. It's just a question of putting the tip in place, using the wood as a guide, and just very slowly drawing your blade against the side of the wood house, and then just going ahead and removing the excess tissue paper. If you cut up a little bit into the side of the house, don't worry about it. I've done that too. You just catch the edge of the wood enough. It really doesn't make any difference. If you take a lot of the gesso off, just go ahead and put a little bit more on there. So now I have this house. all set to go. Let's get that little cutting mat out of the way. I think I'm going to start by working on the side with the big moth on it because I'm so enamored with this particular design. I think it's just wonderful. For my prototype, all I did was use distress markers to color the wings of the moth, and then I came in with the ink pads and the little mending blending tools, and that's how I colored the sides, the fronts, and we'll talk about the sides. Now, on my original prototype, as I said, there's no gesso on here, so I'm not entirely sure how this is going to take, but if it doesn't work as well as I hope, I can simply get out my distress paint in antique linen and in walnut stain, which are the two colors I'm going to use, and I can get some color on the sides that way. I'm not really worried about it. So I'm going to turn this toward me, and let's start bringing in some distress markers. The original colors that I used on the prototype were Tattered Rose, this is Victorian Velvet, Tumbled Glass, Broken China, and I used Pumice Stone, which is a nice kind of gray color. You really can't see that much of it, but the edge of the body is here, and I wanted to color it. So let's start with the Pumice Stone, and really, this is super simple. Because, remember earlier I said that you can feel the moisture from the gel medium or if you use the glue and seal it? Because you can feel that moisture coming through, it really does penetrate the paper, and you can actually move the colors with your finger. So what you'll see is I'm just going to come in here, and I'm going to smudge this around a little bit. Now, if whatever you do doesn't result in you being able to smudge, you can always use a very lightly dampened, just damp, piece of paper towel, and that will help you move the color around. But all of the design is here. You just add color wherever you choose to. It's really that simple. You can come put a little bit in here. Now, if you want to make this a very bright creature, then use colors other than what I've done. Choose the bright colors from the distress line, and I'm sure it'll be beautiful too. So I'm going to start with Tattered Rose, and I'm always going to use the brush end, and I'm going to do the upper part of the wings in Tattered Rose, and I'll probably add, maybe this time I'll add some milled lavender and see how that looks. But all I'm going to do, again, is just brush this on here and come in and finger blend it. That's it. It's really that easy. And I'm not going for perfect coverage because I don't want it to be one solid color. I'm just trying to see where this top wing is. I guess there's some in here too. All I want to do is lightly smudge a suggestion of some color on there. So now I'll come back. Let's put a little bit of the milled lavender in. And there's really not a lot of contrast between these two colors, so I'm not going to see a lot of a difference. I'll come back and use the Victorian Velvet then, since I know it's darker. And I'll actually be able to see what's going on here. If I want to come darken the edges here, now there's not a lot I can do here because a lot of this wing is off the side. But again, really super simple. So now I'll come in with the Tumbled Glass. I'm just trying to find the brush end. And I'm just going to kind of smudge this with my fingers. And what you get is this very subtle kind of indistinct coloring that looks really soft and it looks time-worn, which is kind of in keeping with the rest of what's going on here. All right, so now let me bring in, this is the Broken China. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to darken this outside edge in this darker area here. Really, it's this easy. If you get a little bit where you don't want it, just come back and knock it out. If you need to, grab a Q-tip, dampen it, and you can always pull that color out. But quite honestly, at the end of the day, who knows the difference? So I think that looks fine. I mean, if I wanted to stand here and play with this, I certainly could, but you don't need to see that. You can do whatever it is that makes you happy. Now, I think what I will do is give him just a blue highlight on his eye. And you know what? Maybe I could add just a little bit of blue on his body just to give it a little hint of color. Plenty. I think that works just fine. So the next step is to bring in the mini blending tools. I get much better results with these. I really like these a lot. I'm using antique linen and walnut stain, and I'm going to start with a light color, and all I'm going to do is just come in and smudge some of this color on. Actually, I think mine needs to be re-inked. It doesn't seem like I have a lot of color in here, so I'm going to make a mental note to do that when I'm done here. And again, I'm not going for solid, perfect coverage. That's not what I'm trying to achieve here. I just want to get some color on here so it looks time-worn and it looks like it's been handled over the years. All right, so that looks pretty good. Now, whoops, now I'm going to bring in the walnut stain. This is a very dark color. I'm going to go very, in fact, I used this yesterday. I want to see what's left on here before I start dipping it. And I can see that there's not anything left on there. So I'm just going to very lightly dip in the walnut stain. And I'm going to just touch it in various places. And you can make this as dark as you want. If you want it to be really dark, then of course you can do that. Now there are other brown colors in the distress line. If you like vintage photo better, then go for it. I just chose walnut stain and antique linen. It's a combination that when I'm looking for these colors, when I'm looking for browns, it's a combination that I tend to use. It's one that I know that I like, so that's what I go with. Again, you can put as much or as little of this on here as you want. If I wanted to spend some more time, now you can see that my prototype is a lot darker. Now there's two reasons for that. First of all, because I put more color on there, but remember this one, no gesso. So I don't have any white under here influencing the color that I'm putting on top. If I want to make this darker, I certainly can. So that's that. And then it becomes a question of how do you want to embellish it. So for mine, I worked with, this is the trimmings from the black and white trimming set, and it includes, if I could put my hands on it, it includes, I think, four or five different styles of black and white trimming. Flats, some rounds, and I like this little rickrack, so I chose that. This is a plaquette, and this is a pen nib. So what I'm going to show you, you know what, I do want to look at one thing. Let's see how this works, because I'm not certain. Yeah, see, this is going to be fine. I was thinking I might have to drag out the distress paint, but I'm not feeling like I have to. It's just a question of getting this on there and adding some color. So I think that works fine. And obviously, the variations in the depth of color in the gesso are going to affect your eventual outcome. Okay, so back to this. So what I want to do is I'm going to hit this with the heated craft tool just for a second. Because distress has resins in it that allow it to remain wet a little bit longer, because of course you can emboss with distress ink, I just want to be certain that this is dry before I move on to the next step. Same thing with the markers, although they're water-based and they're going to dry much quicker, but I want to be certain that the distress ink is dry. I don't want to smudge my hands in it, and I don't want it to move as I start to do anything else. So that's probably good enough. Now I like this border effect, and I actually put that on before I put the trimmings on. So I'm going to come in with a pit pen, and it's not going to be straight. Remember, imperfection is so much easier to achieve. And all I'm going to do is just draw the basic outline shape up along the sides, along the peak of the roof, and then back down at the bottom. That's it. It's all she wrote. It's as good as it gets. You can go across the bottom like this or not. I didn't on my prototype, but I did here. Again, it doesn't make any difference. It's just a question of what you like. So the trimming. This is a piece that I previously pre-cut, and you can see that it's just a smidge longer. Now, I did that deliberately. What I did was cut it, and then I hit the ends with some glue. I wanted them to be glued together because this wants to fray just the tiniest bit. By doing this, it removes the possibility that this will fray once it's in place. So what I'm going to do is just trim this. And now I have a nice clean edge. Let's see where I'm going here. And I'm going to trim this a little bit more. And then I'm going to trim the other side so that it fits too. All right, so that's about it right there. This would be ready to go ahead and adhere. And I would use, let's just get this over here. I would use the Aileen's Super Thick Tacky Glue. I like using that. However, before you let that dry in place, you can see that here I have a heart charm. Let me just turn this for you. I have the heart charm here, and what I did was I tucked the little loop that you would string through underneath, so it just gave it a little bit more of a finished edge. Now, this is a much bigger piece, so instead of the heart charm, I decided to go with one of these enameled plaquettes. I can't think of exactly what they're called, but I'll make a note of it on the page where we post the video along with all the other supplies. And I took, this is a remnant rub from the botanical set, and what I'm doing is I'm just going to apply the remnant rub. Now I pre-cut it out and I've got it where I want it to be, just so that you don't have to watch me do that kind of nonsense. And I'm just going to go ahead and I'm going to apply this to this little plaquette. Now it's going to run off the sides because this bird, it's kind of a swooping bird, is a little bit wider than the plaquette is, but that's fine. So I'm just going to grab the edge and start testing. All right, so I can see that the bird is staying in place. And then I can just kind of do this and fold that over. So now that's in place. So what I would do now is place this like this. Again, I can hide that hanging loop under the edge of the trimming, and I still have this kind of fun thing going on here. And then from here, where is my plaquette? Here it is. What I did, these come with holes in them, and what I've done is taken two of the brads and put them through there, and then pressed the legs over, and again with this glue, I've got them held in place so that I can get this on here, and these brads will fill the holes, and I'm not going to have these pieces moving around in the back. Now you can see that this is actually pretty white versus my original one, which is not as white. I thought that for here I needed to tone this down. It was far too white and too contrasty to what was going on here. So what I did, this is mushroom alcohol ink, really easy to do. Let me grab a piece of paper towel. All I'm going to do is just go ahead and put some on here. And this is a pretty dark color, but you'll see that a lot of it's actually going to come up. All right. So now I'm just going to take this and kind of tap. And you can see that by doing this, now technically, could I use the applicator with the felt? Yeah, I could, but this is what I had handy. So I think that's really enough. I don't feel compelled to change the color of that anymore. And if I think that now this is too blendy and too matchy-matchy, I could take some of the blending solution and clean that all off. And I may, it depends on how it looks as I start to assemble it. And then from here, the other option would be if you wanted to use something like a Muse token in the place of this or up here, certainly an option as well. And then I like pen nibs. I'm very fond of these. And I would probably go ahead and apply three of these, just like this, along the bottom. Now, I need to grab a different package. I've probably used up the smaller ones. You can see that the nib is slightly different here, but there are some that are a little bit shorter, and it might be fun to actually vary what's on there instead of having the three of them be identical. But then from here, it's very easy. I can turn this over and do the same thing on the other side. And then, obviously, there are other techniques for the other houses, and I'm going to show you a little bit about them next. Now I'm going to show you how to take a house that's just gessoed like this one is here, and how to take it and have it look something like this. And the answer is finger painting with Dina Wakely's heavy body paints. They work really well for this technique. Now I'm going to take the elements off of here because this is mostly not glued down yet. But the one thing I want you to see is that not only is there paint on here, there's a lot of spattering and speckling on here. And you can kind of see that on all the sides. In all cases, the way that I achieve that, and I'm going to say this now and get it out of the way so that I don't forget, is to take paint, in this case on the white, we're talking about gesso. You put some out on your nonstick surface or your palette. You use a fan brush like this, and you thin it till it's very much ink-like in consistency, and once you have your piece done, you get the stuff, the paint, the thinned paint in your fan brush, and you just tap like this, and that's how you get this spattered look. So that's that. But in the meantime, we have to actually get to the point where we're ready to do that, and I want to show you how that's done. Now, what you're going to notice here and here, you haven't seen this house yet, both of these have stuff on them. They have a raised surface. This is Ranger's texture paste that I put through our number one Punchinello stencil. It has these little quarter inch rounds on it. That's what this is. Now what you maybe don't see quite so well yet, I love hearts along with houses. You do see, again, you see hearts appear with these houses. This is from the same Punchinello Trio stencil, but this is the hearts. Now because texture paste dries kind of clear or translucent, you can't see it real well, but it will start to show up once I apply the paint. And again, all three of these houses were all done the same way, just with different color combinations. So let me show you how easy it is to do all that. Let's get this out of the way. Let's put these someplace where they're not going to get spattered and messy. For this house, I'm going to use lemon, tangerine, whoops, and a little bit of ruby, and I'm going to bring some white in because I want to lighten those colors and make them a little bit more pastel-like. So the first thing I'm going to do is get some white out on my nonstick craft sheet, and then I'm going to put out some of each of the colors. Now my inclination is that this is going to be more yellow than anything else with the orange and the ruby accents. So, well, I wasn't planning to put that much of the turquoise, tangerine out. I just pushed a little bit too much out. So this is really, and honestly, I could probably, if I didn't have to move on for you, I could probably do another house with what's out here. So I'm going to take some of the white and I'm going to mix a little bit of the yellow into it So I get kind of a pretty soft yellow color. I like this. Might be a little bit too light. And is this enough to cover the whole house? Probably not, but it doesn't make any difference because I'm going to mix so many other colors on top of this, it's not going to make a darn bit of difference. So it's really just a question of coming in, and now you can see those hearts begin to emerge. It's just a question of coming in and rubbing the colors on with your finger. Now, the one thing that you don't want to do is put gloppy layers on. They take too long to dry. Now, we're using colors that are they're near each other on the color wheel, so they're going to work together and it doesn't make any difference. I wouldn't make mud with any of these colors, but what I don't want to do is get too much blending going on. I'd rather have layers, and that gives me a little bit of a different look. Now, on the end grain, when you work with the end grain like this, you're going to notice you can feel the way the paint sucks right in there. It's very different than the smooth surfaces, and I'm going to come back with a little bit of the darker yellow. It's very different than working on the smooth front of this, but you'll feel that at the end of the day, the house is going to stand on that end, so you're not going to get perfect color on there, but I do like to just put something on there so there is some color on there. So now I think I'm going to grab a little bit of the tangerine and start rubbing that in. Now my paint is not totally dry, so I am getting a little bit of blending going on. If I wanted to stop and force this to dry, I could either stop and wait, or I could hit it with the heated craft tool. For, again, because the colors I'm using are not going to muddy, I'm not too worried about it, but I am just going to kind of give this a second to dry. And this is the reason to use very thin layers. It allows you to come in, that's a little bit too much, it allows you to come in and add color quickly because it's dry, or it's mostly dry. So that was a little bit more than I wanted. So let's just lighten this up a little bit, put some up here. Now I've got more pink than red. Again, I can come back and I can layer some yellow over this. Totally, not totally dry, but close enough. And this really is how I go ahead and put the colors on. Now I need to bring the craft tool in. I do need to get this to dry just for a second in order to really get some more layers on there. But this is the process. You just add color, you kind of squish it around in all different directions. I don't worry about finger marks. I don't worry about a whole heck of a lot of anything other than getting some color on there. And I also don't worry about whether or not the background is completely covered. If there's some white showing through, then as far as I'm concerned, that's fine too. All right, this is pretty close. I can feel that it's only tacky in a few spots. So I think I'm going to come back and add a little bit more yellow and strengthen that color here. And I can do that now because this is mostly dry. And this is the process. You add as much or as little as you like. It's entirely up to you. Okay, so now I'm not going to do all of the sides, but what I do need to do is dry this, and then I want to come back and I want to show you the magic that happens when you bring in Inca Gold. So let me get this, what I'll do is I'm going to get all the rest of the sides done, then I'm going to come back and show you how cool the Inca Gold is and all the fun ways that you can work with it. Here are the houses that have texture paste put through a stencil on them, and you can see that you can do lots of different things here to really make that stand out. Now right now, you're not seeing too much of that too much of the hearts on this one because I haven't really done anything to make them leap up off the surface of the house. And that's where Inca Gold is going to come in. Now you'll notice here that there's Inca Gold here. You can really see it reflecting in the light from up above. Putting it on the texture is not the only thing that you can do. You can certainly add it anywhere that you want, and I've added it to other pieces that don't have texture on them, and it works real well. And then we're going to talk about what you're going to do for your doors and your windows, and if I hold this again to the light, you can see that there's some Inca Gold on here. So there's lots of different ways to incorporate the colors and the shine from Inca Gold into these wonderful little houses. So I've got three colors here. I'm just going to take the lids off so I can get to them. And then I'm going to start applying them a little bit at a time. So you can see, now that's probably too close, so let me come in with this. I want to start rubbing some color on here. What's going to happen is that I'm going to get color on the top of the heart, but I'm not going to get it so much down in between. If I want to, I can really load my finger up and do that. And then, of course, I can come in here and do this too. Now, you can see that there are some dots on here. I've already splatted this with the ruby, and it's a little harder to see, but I did it with the white as well. So it is there. Now, if I think that's a little bit too much, I can start rubbing some of that off before it really sets up. And actually, I've rubbed some of it and revealed what's underneath, and I think that looks pretty cool. So it's just a question of how much of this you want to add and how much you want to play with. Now the nice thing about ink and gold is that it's going to dry relatively quickly. So I can come back, let's just see how this feels. I can come back and I can start to put some of the lighter color over the top and really make those hearts jump out. And there's, you know, I will tell you that what you see here was lots of different layers because I kept looking at it thinking, that's not what I want, that's not what I want. I came back and just kept adding layers until I eventually got what I wanted, and then I was far more satisfied with it. So you do kind of have to play around. One of the things that I've discovered is if you want the look of layers, the only real way to get that is by applying lots of layers. So I'm very fond of, this is the color that's called Champagne. It's a very buttery yellow that I really like a lot. So I incorporate this a lot when I use ink and gold because I really like the color. So it's really this simple. You can do more if you want. And obviously I have two sides here. So even though the reverse that I'm holding against my hand is going to be the front of this, that doesn't mean I can't add ink and gold to the back too if I want. So again, very simple, very straightforward, and produces beautifully shiny results. All you have to do is let this just dry for a moment or two, and then you can buff it to bring the shine up. Very straightforward, really easy to do. All right, let's come back around to the front and see how this looks. I think I'm going to bring some of this back in. Again, I'm looking for layers and color, and this is really the way to achieve that. Now, obviously, I've got all that paint going on that we applied a few moments ago, so that's there as well. And it all comes together to create a really nice whole. I think it's time for some more yellow. Again, I keep playing until I'm super satisfied with the way that this looks. And I would advise you to do the same till you get the look that you want. And so, basically, this is it. So let me just cover the ink of gold. Now, one of the things that I will tell you about ink of gold, you can see the big crack in here. I don't know what it is that Viva does with them, but they don't stay tight and they do start to dry out. Every month or so I come in and I spritz them to keep them moist, and I just leave them back sitting in my container where I have them all, and I do try to keep the jar lids screwed on really tight so that they don't dry out, but it just seems to be the nature of the beast. So alright, with this drying, now what I'm going to do is come back and I'm going to buff the color up, and the ink of gold takes on a really nice shine, very glimmery, really, really pretty to work with. Now, having said that, when it gets glossy like this, and again, you can see all the reflection there, when it gets glossy like this, it becomes a glossy surface. So you have to give some thought about what you're going to use, if you're going to apply paint over it or if you want to use markers over it, because certain water-based markers are not going to be happy with this. So you just give that some thought. When it comes time, let's turn this over. When it comes time to do the windows and the doors, and you can see the door on here. Now, for my big piece, this one right here, you can see that I've started here, and I will tell you, next segment I'm gonna talk about various elements that you can use for embellishments, but for me, for the windows and the doors, what I'm doing is taking 90-pound watercolor paper, and I'm gonna show you how I color this to get this effect, and then I'm just really outlining it with a pit pen. It's pretty darn straightforward. So to get this kind of stripey look, I'm going to come in with Tim Holtz's water brushes with dilutions and color wash in them. This was done all on 90-pound watercolor paper. This was done by just taking spritz bottles of color and spritzing it. You can see the pattern is very different, but spritzing is nothing. Let me show you what I'm going to do here. So here's some 90-pound watercolor paper. I have wild plum. I think this is sunset orange. This is cranberry. So all I would do, first of all, if I think this is too dark, I'd put some water out. If I think it's going to be too dark, I'll just hit the tip of the brush part of the pen with the water so that that color is not so dark. If I want it darker, then I can just certainly make certain that I feed the color right down through the tip. Ultimately, what I'm looking for is this kind of scratchy, not blended color. I just want to get some on there. Again, same kind of thing here. You can put as much or as little as you like. And then this is wild plum. This is going to be pretty dark, so I think I'm going to just start by lightening that so that it doesn't take over too much. So this is what I would kind of plan to do for the doors and the windows on here. I think this works pretty well. Now, if I think that this is too matchy-matchy, if it's too close, I can come back with the wild plum, and I can deepen this up a little bit. And that probably actually looks a little bit better. There's a little bit more contrast. Then what I can do I need to dry this first. But then what I can do, once this is dry, is bring back the Inca Gold, and I can add a little bit of shimmer. But it's got to be dry before you do that. All right, this is dry enough. So I'm going to bring the champagne back in. Just going to touch my finger on there, and then I'm going to lightly just apply some Inca Gold. I'm not looking for solid coverage. I just want to get some color and some shimmer on there. Again, same thing as a moment ago with the house itself. You let this dry, and once it is, you take a piece of paper towel and you buff it up to a shine. And then from there, all you have to do is draw the shapes of your windows and your doors, cut them out, place them where you want them. Now, I generally don't glue a lot of things down until I know everything that I'm going to do. But having said that, you can certainly start by getting your doors and windows if you want. You can see that I've got some tissue tape up here. This is from Tim's. This is the Industrious Border Frames and Trims Ideology. Again, another one of the plaquettes. Now here, the stark white works just fine. This is one of the arrow adornments. This is a mirrored star, but let me come back in a second. I'll get all this lined up and I can show you the various ways to embellish these. When it's time to think about what you want to use for embellishments, the answer, as Dina Wakely says, is yes. That means you can pretty much do anything that you want. Now, I mostly have stuck to ideology here, primarily because I love it and I have lots of it hanging around, and it's useful in oh so many ways. So let me walk you through a few of the things that you see here. Now, the first thing that I will tell you, the most important thing, is to use the correct glue. When you're gluing something like this mini numeral, which is metal, to a wood surface, you need to use a glue that's going to be compatible with that shiny non-porous surface as well as with the wood. So in all cases when I'm working with something like that, I'm going to use the super thick tacky glue. It works beautifully. I have yet to have it fail. I can't say enough about it. So that's your first thing. If wanting to get whatever you're putting on there to dry in a hurry is important, something like the Scotch Quick Dry Adhesive, also very, very good. It sets up very quickly, which means you can't make a mistake because you have very little time to rework it. But again, it's important to use whatever glue that you think is appropriate. Now, the other thing that I would say is use something a little bit out of the ordinary. This is one of the ideology, let me just tip this, this is one of the ideology monocles, and this is one of my scribble flowers that I probably drew a year and a half ago. The colors worked. It was small enough to fit in the monocle, and I thought it made kind of an interesting window effect up here. Having said that, this is a curio knob. Now, it's a knob, and ordinarily you wouldn't think of it as a doorknob on a piece like this, but size-wise, it mostly fits. When you use something like this, it's typically meant to go through something with this screw, and you screw it in place. But because I want this to lay flat against the surface, I'm going to save this. I'm going to take it out and not use it, and I'm going to put it to one side, and I'm actually going to, again, I'm going to come back, and I'm going to use this glue to put this in place. Heart charms, they work perfectly well too. Now, the one thing that you're going to notice about this house that's quite different than everything else is the fact that it's much quieter than the rest of these. There's not all of this fun mixed media splashes of color. Instead, what I chose to do was the roof one color and the house another color. And if you look at the sides, you can see that that's kind of carried through to the sides as well. So that's an option. And when you have something that's a little bit quieter like this, it does allow you the versatility to come back and use scrapbook papers, which can be busy, in place of the what you saw me make when we did this with the colors in the brush. You can go ahead and use that, so you can use scrapbook paper for your windows and your doors. The other thing that you can do is you can use chit-chat stickers. I'm very fond of them. You see one here and here, and someplace I have another one. I don't know what I did with it, but I have one that's earmarked to go along the top of this door if I've left myself enough room, because I've got this star here. So chit-chat stickers are perfect. Now, as they come from the package, you have two options. They come printed in this, whoops, they come printed in this craft color, and they're also available in white. Now, the nice thing about the white is that you can kind of color it anything that you want, or you can just leave it alone, but that's a great option too. And speaking of coloring things, again, this is a mirrored star, this is a mirrored star. You can color the mirrored stars in the same way that you saw me color, let me grab my alcohol ink, in the same way that you saw me go ahead and color, what did I color earlier? Oh, the plaquette, that's what it was. I changed the color on it because I thought it was a little bit too stark white. So here are some stars that I might earmark for the house. And I've got two colors. This is pink sherbet, and someplace here I have a little bit of wild plum. So it's really straightforward. The same thing you saw me do with the plaquette. You're just going to put a little, well, that was more than a little drop, but you're just going to put some color on there, and you can see that it's going to be pretty light. So if you want, this is wild plum, if you want something darker, you can come back and touch that. Now, again, you could use the alcohol ink applicator with the felt on it, or you can just kind of dab like this. It doesn't, I mean, if I were applying on a glossy surface because I was trying to get a background, then I would absolutely use the applicator and the felt. But for this, it's really not necessary. But the cool thing is you can color these stars anything that you want them to be. And they come in a pack someplace here. They come in a pack with multiple sizes and lots of them. So that's an option. Industrious stickers. I talked about these a little bit earlier. This is the frames and trim sets, and it has these nice narrow borders. What I think I'm going to do is put this on here like this to kind of create a roof line so that the roof remains separated from the body of the house. Now, these are self-adhesive, but this is kind of glossy and it's definitely uneven, so I'm going to revert back to this to help it stay in place, and that'll make certain that it doesn't move after the fact. You can see that I've used the zigzaggy one, the one that's a little bit more jagged as opposed to scallops here. This is from, there's another Industrious stickers. It's called Borders, I want to say, and it has these arrows in it. So this is an option as well. And if you are very fond of arrows, this is the Ideology Arrow Adornments. So lots of different ways that you can do that. You can, houses typically have numbers on them. So whether you achieve that with a plaquette or you use something like the alpha parts, and even though it says alpha parts, it does include numerals as well, you can do something like that. Now they come from the package black, but you can use distress paint, tap it on there, and get them to be any color that you want. So again, the answer to how you can embellish this is yes. Anything that you want to do, you pretty much can. And let me just step out of the shot here for 1 second, bring in the houses that we started with to remind you that if bright is not your thing, then you don't have to go bright. This is an option too.